Okay, good morning, everyone. Welcome to OPPN 10, which is the YIA oral presentation. It's a pity we can't be in Seville in the sun, but it's still good to be able to talk together. So we have three presentations, which will follow consecutively. I remind the speakers to try and stick to time, and we'll have 5 minutes questions after each. Our first speaker is for abstract 1863, Fernandez Sanjurjo, and the title of the presentation is MER-29A, a new plasma biomarker in exercise. Over to you, Manuel.
Well said, I'm going to talk about microRNA 29A and its biomarker in exercise. In 2018, it was with some collaborators that exosomes can create intertissular crosstalk during exercise. In those exosomes, they were focused on proteomics, but there are another molecules there which could be studied. One of those was RNA, non-coding RNAs, which is called microRNAs. These microRNAs are non-coding RNAs, small non-coding RNAs, between 22 and 25 nucleotides, which control or regulate the expression, the gene expression, at the level of translation. In this case, this microRNA could produce this role in the same cell as they were produced, or they could go outside this cell and doing their interaction in another tissue. These characteristics produce the response or the purpose of these molecules as biomarkers of different physiological or pathological responses. In this circulating levels, they could be associated with proteins as aragonite 2, with lipoproteins, which HDL, or could be in vesicles such as exosomes or microvesicles. This produces an unstable state in all human biofluids, so they could be, as I said, purpose as biomarkers. You know, specifically, in the context of exercise, they were studied in different perspectives, and they are nowadays characterized as specific profiles in different doses of exercise, in different kinds of exercise or models of exercise, in acute response, and during training periods. However, one of them appears as a key muscle modulator, which was MER-29. It was described by Mazard and collaborators in 2017 as an exercise regulator at muscle level, and they produce, if they are overexpressed, a reduction in insulin sensitivity and glucose uptake, and if they are repressed, an increasement in lipid oxidation. So our aim of this study was to clarify the role of circulating microRNA 29 as a new biomarker in exercise response. The experimental design has two parts, one part in human, one part in mice. In the part of human, we have three groups, control sedentary ones, endurance athletes, and resistance athletes, and they are comparable with mice groups. We have a control mice group, sedentary, one resistance-trained mice group, and endurance-trained. The training was 4 weeks of training, 5 days per week, with an increasement of intensity during these weeks. All of them are young mice, and in the case of humans, the same, young adults. We take in basic conditions the plasma of those mice and those humans, then we extract the exosomes of those plasma, Then we start again microRNA from those exosomes. We create the cDNA, and then we analyze any time by qPCR. Results was that we have no changes in the human profile, only 1.5-fold change in the case of endurance. But in mice, we conclude that there is an increasement in the circulating response, exosomal circulating response of resistance trained mice compared to control and endurance ones. Going deeper in analysis, if they are described as muscle regulators, we take muscles from the mice, quadriceps, and then we analyze two, another tissue, which was described by Whitham, which is the target of the exosomes, which is the liver. So we analyze in both tissues the level of Mi-29, and there is no change in response to train. Yes, but obviously, there is an increasement in the performance, also in endurance and in strength capacity, during the training period, but there is no change in microRNA 29 response. However, if we correlate the relationship between strength capacity and endurance capacity improvement, performance improvement in both groups, we are correlated at muscle level with Mi-29 expression. Positive, and also is needed to have more animals and more trained animals to conclude or validate this correlation also. At this point, we know that microRNA 29 has a role in exercise adaptation, so we have to clarify which is the performance, exercise performance in knockout mice, Mi-29A. Mi-29A knockout mice was described by Carabian and colleagues in PLOS Biology in 2018, and they described an increasement in PGC1 alpha and a mitochondrial hyperplasia in these animals, and also an increasement in fat oxidation of these animals with the completely disappear the adipose tissue in the animals compared to wild type. So we try to identify the exercise performance of this animal or characterize this performance in resistance and in endurance. When we perform that, we have that the resistance test has decreasement of 50% of the performance in comparing knockout mice with wild type. In the case of endurance, the decreasement is less, and it's only 23%, which is the decrease between knockout mice and wild type. Why it should be produced? Because some part of the test, of the endurance test, could be done fuel of lipid metabolism. So the difference is slightly small in the case of endurance compared to resistance test, where the carbohydrate fuel is the basic one. So considering all the results, we have that circulating level, Mi-29A 3P, changes in resistance strain mice. Taking into account knockout mice, when Mi-29A is not present, resistance was decreased, and endurance also was decreased, but we have noticed that what was described was that an increasement in lipid oxidation, and we observed the same. However, it was described with an enrichment on Mi-29A, a decrease in insulin sensitivity and insulin glucose uptake But in the knockout animals, they have a hyperglycemia in plasma. So this, we are completely agree with the part of the lipid oxidation, but in the part of diabetes and comparing with glucose uptake, they have no data to compare. Also, we have done a different perspective in humans, which was Scandinavian Journal 2018-20, where we can identify the role of Mi-29A during the season, and we can observe that a decreasement along the season, during the season, related with the accumulation of training, of endurance training for the best performance in a marathon run. So this could be related with the mitochondrial biogenesis, increase in PGC1 alpha, which was described related with repression in this microRNA. So all in all, welcome miR-20NA3P can be proposed as a new exercise biomarker and as main determinant of fatty acid metabolism in exercise.
Thank you. Thank you for keeping to time as well. So I'll now open the floor to my colleagues who are reviewing the abstract, if they have any comments, questions they'd like to make.
Thank you for that very nice presentation. Can you hear me well?
Yes.
Okay, good. So my first question will be, is there the exosomes that contain the miR-29A, where are they coming from? How sure are you that they're coming from muscle or from other organs? Do you have any insights on that?
I have analyzed muscle defector, but I don't think that there is the tissue which generates these exosomes, because there is no correlation between circulation levels and tissue levels. This is why we don't think about this as the first effector, but not the generator of these exosomes.
So what do you speculate? What is the generator of these exosomes?
To improve this knowledge and try to find in mice, because we can proceed to some tissues, but obviously there are some proposed as endothelial tissue as one of the main determinants in circulating levels of microRNA.
Okay, thank you.
Morning, I'd like to ask a question, Paul.
Go ahead.
So I was wondering why you think the microRNA 29 is a biomarker for exercise when the data in the humans, they didn't seem to be very strong.
I think that in the case of humans, I think there is a disbalance between the exosomes and the complete plasma response, because when we analyze in other samples in humans, you can see a differences associated with the training load. But in the case of exosome response, when we analyze exosomes, we have no differences. So it could be possible to microRNA 20NA in the case of humans are present in another type of circulation, like lipoproteins or agonaut to proteins and not in the exosomes. It could be.
I just wondered if it might be something to do with the 29A specifically, rather than, did you investigate any of the other isoforms?
I didn't hear you all.
So I just wondered if your results might be because you're investigating the 29A microRNA specifically rather than the B or C.
Yeah, it could be. But when we analyze miR-20AB, which is associated in the same cluster, we have the same response in the case of human in the Scandinavian journal, which is just published, and we see that they are correlated. They have the same expression in acute response to a marathon and then in the same response during the whole season.
Okay. I just had one more point that perhaps you could help clarify for me. My understanding of the paper that reports the knockout of microRNA 29, that seemed quite a pathological effect. So those animals had hypertension and other cardiovascular problems. So how does that fit with your idea that it could be an exercise biomarker.
Yeah, we have analyzed before the phenotype of the knockout mouse is complete, a 16-week, but obviously when this appear, when microRNAs are knockout, they create a pathological symptoms since I think that 17th week. So we try to take some conclusions on the exercise metabolism, but obviously they have to be conscious that these knockout mice, they are not realistic, a realistic model of the exercise response, obviously. But we are trying to modulate the expression of other microRNA in response to exercise in these knockout mice, training this knockout to searching new insights in this field.
Okay, thank you.
We have 1 minute, Wim. Is there a question you want to ask?
Yeah, I was wondering, have you considered an untargeted approach instead? Because now you see that that there's one, that you target on one microRNA out of hundreds or thousands, and it's one that doesn't go up. Shouldn't you have first considered to look at the ones that go up with exercise and then do your work?
I have a global approach of sequencing all the microRNAs present in exosomes, but for this paper, or for this study, we've tried to select one to be as short as we need in this presentation of 10 minutes, but we have also done a global approach of sequencing all the microRNAs and looking for all the changes in the different plasma secretion in athletes and sedentary control as compared.
Okay, and some go up much higher than the word 29.
Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt. We're out of time. Thank you for your presentation. We now move on to the second presenter, Corral Perez, and this is abstract 1375, influence of FTO RS9939609 polymorphism on appetite sensation and energetic balance in young adults.
Okay, thank you very much for the presentation. And I'm going to start giving a little more context. We all know that obesity has been increasing in the past years, and it's accurately estimated right now that 13% of the adult population worldwide is obese right now. And given that, obesity has been associated with cardiovascular and metabolic diseases and a higher risk of death, understanding how do we get to this condition is fundamental. And being that worldwide and generally, we can understand obesity as a condition that is characterized by a lack of physical activity or a bad management of energy intake or a combination of both, we sometimes forget that genetics can also play a direct role in this condition. And it has been published in the recent year that genes such as melanocortin-4 receptor, cholecystokinin, the fat mass and obesity associated, FTO, the ghrelin or leptin genes directly affect obesity. And so have stated that between 40 and 70% of obesity is determined by these types of genes. So it's quite important to understand how these genes affect this condition and how to prevent obesity. In the concept that we are going to study today, the FTO is a gene that is located in the long arm of chromosome 16 on position 12.2. It's composed by 9 exons occupying an area of more than 400 kilobases, composed of alleles A and T, and the RS9939609 variation is the most studied in the literature. FTO have been associated with body composition variables such as BMI, body mass index, or fat or body fat, being the ones with the A allele, which is the risk allele, the ones who have higher rates of these variables. It's also have been associated with energy intake, with the people, again, with the A allele being associated with higher energy intakes than the group with the TT. It have been also associated with appetite, with higher levels of postprandial hunger in the people who were homogeneous AA, and even with variables such as fat oxidation, with the TT group having higher half fat oxidation during exercise than the one who had ALL. However, these studies have studied these variables along with the FTO. We think it is interesting to study all these variables at the same time in the same sample with this gene. So the objectives of this study is to investigate whether body composition, maximal fat oxidation, and energetic balance are influenced by FTO polymorphism, and to examine the association between FTO alleles and appetite before and after doing exercise. This study is part of the NUTAC project, where participants were between 18 and 40 years with stable weight and no diet the 6 months before or prior to the study, and with no disease, injury, or hypertension. The total sample was 74 participants, 46 were men, 28 were females, and with a mean age of 23 years old, more or less. In the first visit, participants were given a 7-day dietary record to assess the daily energy intake, and a physical activity was measured using accelerometer for 7 consecutive days. If participants didn't have a digital scale to measure their foods, we provided them with one, and the accelerometer was an Actigraph GT3X, which was worn at the lower back for 7 consecutive days. The second visit was the laboratory visit, and we assessed appetite sensation using a visual analog scale. We did a resting indirect calorimetry to estimate resting metabolic rate and an incremental exercise to determine maximal fat oxidation. Using the visual analog scale, we assess hunger, satisfaction, fullness, and food preference using this questionnaire right here, but in a Spanish version for all participants. For the resting indirect calorimetry, participants stay for 30 minutes in a supine position, and then we estimate the resting metabolic rate. And for the incremental protocol test, consisted in 2 phases, the phase 1 with increments of 30 values every 3 minutes and finish when the respiratory ratio hits 1. And the second phase, after 3 or 5 minutes of rest, increments of 30 values every 1 minute and finish at exhaustion. And last but not least, the third visit was the blood extraction to determine the genotyping using a predesigned assay. And we determine the people who were AA, AT, or TT. When we did the frequency studies, we detected that the people who were AA, the number of people was too low. So we decided for going to for abdominal allele model, which have been used in other studies, and compare AA plus AT with the group TT. Then we introduce a new variable that's energetic balance that help us understand if our participants were in a superavit, energetic superavit, or an energetic deficit. And it was calculated using the daily energy minus the energy intake measured using the 7-day dietary record. And daily energy consists in resting metabolic rate plus the kilocalories burned during physical activity measured by the accelerometer. And statistical analysis were an ANOVA with one Ferroni correction. The results show us that for body composition variables such as body mass index and fat max, there were no difference between group and both variables. For fat oxidation, we detected that the people in the TT group have higher rates of fat oxidation during exercise than the one in the dominant model. And for energetic balance, we detected the same trend. The people who were in the TT group have an energetic superavit higher than the ones who were in AA plus AT group. For appetite, no difference were found for almost every of the variables studied, except for one, for hunger, which remains the same. Before exercise, there were no difference between groups, but post-exercise, the group with the TT have higher rates of were hungrier than the ones in the AA and AT group. So in discussions, we detected or we showed that for body composition variable, no difference were found between groups. However, this is not what the literature has been saying through all those years, showing that the ALL, that the risk allele, is associated with higher BMI and whole body fat mass. However, we will try to explain why this could happen in this study. For energy intake on energetic balance, we show that the TT group have higher positive energetic balance than AA plus AT. And here there is controversy because this new variable has two main factors, physical activity and resting metabolic rate, that seems to not be affected by this gene and energy intake. And some have stated that even though a variation of a gene affects this energy intake, the ones who are really associated or highly associated with energy intake are the RS 1292170 and the RS 1244607. We didn't study this variable, so probably we are losing the whole picture, only focusing in one variation. For fat oxidation, TT had higher rates of fat oxidation during exercise than the group that were AA plus AT. And this data is consistent with previous studies. And last, for appetite, TT were hungrier than AA plus AT after exercise. And only we have found one study have done the same protocol as us and suggest the same trend. They didn't find any significant difference between the groups, but they show that the TT group have higher rates of hunger after doing an incremental protocol. So in conclusion, we can say that FTO polymorphism may exert an influence on appetite post-exercise, increasing the levels of hunger in the TT group. This result might suggest that TT people are more prone to overeat after exercising, and this could also explain the difference in energetic balance between allele and the no difference in body composition variables. Last, longitudinal studies are needed to clarify the effect of FTO gene on appetite and body composition after a follow-up period, because this is a descriptive study and also have several limitations as mentioned before. So thank you very much, and I'm open to question and suggestion.
Thank you. If I could ask Wim to go first this time, given he only had a minute the last time.
Okay, thank you. I'm a little bit confused with your last with your conclusions that you say the TT or the T allele people have more hunger, but they are known to have the allele that has the lowest BMI. So how is that compatible with each other?
Well, probably I didn't explain myself correctly. In our sample, there was no difference in BMI. So this was the first alert we detected, because as you mentioned, the people with the ALL are usually have higher rates of BMI, are more overweight than the ones with the TT. And as a descriptive study, we cannot say or create a casual interaction, but we detected that the people with a TT allele were hungrier after doing incremental protocol, after doing exercise. And as I mentioned, but our participants were quite active, and we can assume that because of that activity, if they are hungry after doing exercise, they are more prone to overeat, and that will try to will create that overweight or that increase in fat mass.
Okay, thank you.
Jatin or Luke?
Yes, so I'd like to ask a question. First of all, thank you for your presentation. I was just wondering how you know confident you can be with your findings about appetite or hunger when your population seems quite different. So the FTO polymorphism is quite well researched, and in your population you don't have a difference in obesity or fat mass. So have you looked at the power of your study, or you know, the sample size that you had, and could that be a factor?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that for limitation we have a medium large cohort, but for that reason, that I tried to explain in the conclusions, more studies are needed with large samples, because as a descriptive study, for budget reason we couldn't have more people. But in the future, we will try to with these two people to be able to create larger samples and detect if what we have found is just casualty, of it's a trend during those type of people.
And do you think more people will answer the question because there have been a few studies looking at FTO polymorphism and exercise, and usually there isn't an interaction between the whichever polymorphism you look at and exercise response?
I'm sorry, didn't get you. Can you repeat?
I was just asking if you think just adding more participants is the answer, because there have been a few studies that have already shown there's no interaction between FTO polymorphism and exercise responses.
Yeah, Bill, they don't have a study, as you mentioned there, and it seems that it's not affected FTO by the physical activity, but to our knowledge, they have only studied like different factors alone, and what we try to do is understand all these factors and how these factors can affect each other. So even though that FTO cannot affect physical activity could affect all factors that are also affected by FTO and generate like a system. I don't know if I'm explaining it correctly. And try to understand it like a whole picture more than just separate parts of the same gene.
Okay, thank you.
I'm sorry, we're out of time, so we will have to move to the next speaker. Thank you for your presentation, Juan.
Thank you very much.
So our final speaker in this session is Bokov and colleagues, and the title of the presentation is Dynamics of Human Skeletal Muscle Transcriptome Changes After Endurance Exercise, Co-regulated Genes and Upstream Regulators. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I start my presentation. Human skeletal muscle transcriptome changes after an acute aerobic exercise were investigated in the several studies, but analysis of literature showed that there are still no studies that investigated in detail the transcriptome dynamics after an acute aerobic exercise. So the aim of our work was to study dynamics of human skeletal muscle transcriptome after an acute aerobic exercise to identify co-expressed genes and their transcription factors. It is important to note that in trained human skeletal muscle, gene changes of gene expression after acute exercise are less pronounced and more specific than in untrained human skeletal muscle. Therefore, amateur endurance trained athletes were involved in our study. 10 males performed 1 hour intermittent exercise on bicycle ergometer with 12 bouts, duration 5 minutes, 3 minutes of 50% of anaerobic threshold and 2 minutes of 100% of anaerobic threshold. The blood lactate in the end of high intensity bouts was 5 millimole, and the average oxygen consumption rate during the high intensity bouts was 85% of maximum oxygen consumption rate. So it means that our exercise induced substantial metabolic shift. Biopsies from musculus vastus lateralis were taken prior to exercise and at the first, at the third, and at the six hours of recovery. We evaluated changes of transcriptome profile in response to exercise using CAGE method. We examined co-expressed, differently expressed genes, and finally we predicted transcription factors associated with co-expressed, with differently expressed genes using position weight matrices method. In this slide, each cycle shows number of upregulated or downregulated differently expressed genes in each time points of recovery. We found that there are several hundred genes were changed the expression, with 60% of them were upregulated. And also it is important to note that most differently expressed genes were unique for each time point of recovery. That means that transcriptome dynamically changes during recovery period. Next, we performed gene ontology analysis to understand which biological processes were associated with differently expressed genes. From 30 to 50 upregulated genes were associated with regulation of transcription in each time point of recovery. About 20 upregulated genes were associated with regulation of angiogenesis at the first and the third hours of recovery. And about 30 downregulated genes were associated with regulation of transcription and only at the sixth hour of recovery. So we can conclude that regulation of transcription is key biological process associated with gene expression changes after acute aerobic exercise. It is well known that transcription factors, mRNAs and transcription factor proteins have a short half-life. So we found that increase of expression of transcription factor mRNAs in early hours of recovery. We think, we presume that will lead to increase of contents of transcription factor proteins in the late stages of recovery. And that may play important role in regulation of expression of target genes of transcription factors in the late stages of recovery and in regulation of gene response to the next exercise. The next goal of our work was to identify groups of co-expressed genes and their transcription factors. Shades of red and blue show up and down regulated genes respectively. Genes that did not change the expression shown in white. Vertical lines show about 1,000 differently expressed genes that changed the expression at the first or at the third or at the sixth hour of recovery. Different genes have different dynamics of gene expression in recovery period. So to identify co-expressed genes, we perform cluster analysis. This picture shows 15 clusters of co-expressed genes, genes this similar magnitudes and direction of response. For example, genes from this cluster increase the expression at the first hour of recovery. Genes from this cluster increase the expression at the third and the sixth hours of recovery. And genes from this cluster decreased the expression at the third hour of recovery. We assume that genes with similar dynamics are regulated by the same transcription factors. To predict these transcription factors, we used the positional weight matrices method. And to reduce the false positive prediction rate, we used two most complete position weight matrices databases, TransFAC and Hokomoka. We find the most enriched transcription factors binding motifs in promoter region of co-expressor genes. and the enrichment was found for several clusters. Interestingly, that for some predicted transcription factors, some predicted transcription factors were upregulated at the first hour of recovery. It can confirm with our hypothesis that that increase in expression of transcription factor mRNAs in early hours of recovery will lead to increase in content of transcription factor proteins. It is well known that transcription factors may act as homo or heterodimeric complexes to change expression of their target genes, to regulate expression of their target genes. This figure shows predicted bias transcription factors. Each line, the thickness of each line indicates the significance of interaction, which based on the literature analysis. We found two groups of potential protein-protein interactions. They are shown in green and red colors. Interestingly, that the biggest group of predicted transcription factors concluded transcription factors of AP1 family and transcription of ATF CREB family, which both belong to the BZIP class of transcription factors. And they presume that transcription factors of BZIP class play an important role in upregulation of differently expressed genes in recovery periods. Also interestingly, that transcription factors WT1 and ZNF148 were associated with upregulated genes at the first hour of recovery and were associated with downregulated genes at the sixth hour of recovery. According to the human gene database gene cards, these genes are repressors, so maybe they can act as activators and repressors in different time points of recovery. Summing up, firstly, transcriptome dynamically changes during 6 hours of recovery after exercise. Noteworthy changes in gene expression predominantly associated with upregulation. Secondly, most of the genes that change the expression after exercise encode transcription factors. Thirdly, transient increase in the expression of transcription factor genes may play an important role in regulation of expression of the target genes at the late stages of recovery and so in regulation of gene response to next exercise. And finally, we presume that transcription factors of BZIP class play an important role in upregulation of gene response after exercise. Moreover, the same transcription factors can act as activators or repressors in different stages of recovery. Thank you for attention.
Thank you, Roman. Questions from colleagues?
Morning. Thank you very much for your presentation. I'd just like to ask, so the cage technique that you use can be helpful in identifying start sites. So I wondered, did you identify any changes in transcription start sites over the time course of the response to exercise?
Yes, cage method allows us to determine transcription start sites in each gene. RNA-seq method allows us to determine nucleotide sequences, but cage method allows us to find transcription start sites, and using this information, we can find promoter regions and find most enriched transcription factor binding motifs.
So I wondered, were there any changes in transcription start site or effector regions in response to exercise?
Repeat, please. It's a problem with hearing.
So different enhancers and promoters can be used, and I wondered if part of the response of the transcriptome to exercise involves a change in the use of the different promoter or enhancer regions.
Yes, of course, but we found promoter engines for differently expressed genes that changed expression in our study after acute exercise, if I understand your question.
Okay. Yes, yes, that's fine. And I just had a second question.
Okay.
So I was wondering about the time course that you chose to investigate, because previously you've used either 1 or 4 hours, and now you've increased to 1, 3, and 6. But in particular, you began by saying that the transcription response can be different in trained people. And recent work, from your group, has shown that actually the acute transcription response of trained people doesn't match very well to the protein response.
Repeat, please, your question. I had a problem with connection.
So I'm wondering why you chose to investigate the acute responses to exercise in trained people when previously you've shown that the basal mRNA expression in trained muscle is more closely linked to the protein response.
Okay, for you, the trained endurance trained athletes were involved in our study because we have the main aim of our study was to evaluate gene expression, changes of gene expression is in trained human skeletal muscle. It was interesting for us to evaluate transcriptome changes and find predict transcription factors, because in the last works in our studies in our laboratory, for example, we showed that human in trained human skeletal muscle gene expression changes after exercise less pronounced and more specific than in untrained human skeletal muscle. So for us it was interesting to evaluate to study transcriptome profile changes of trained human skeletal muscles.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, can I ask a question, Paul?
Go ahead, okay. Will.
Yeah, I was wondering in your design, you did not include a control day. Would that been a valuable and would that have impacted in some way your results? So a rest day where you do the same protocol but no exercise.
Your question about exercise protocol, yes?
Why we
use this protocol?
Why not a rest or control condition to compare your data?
Used this protocol based on our previous laboratory experience, and we did not use a control group. We only used a group of trained athletes.
Could the repeated biopsy, for example, be a factor? Could the diet be a factor? Could the circadian rhythms be a factor that should be excluded?
Okay. Circadian rhythms and feeding also can affect on the gene expression. We understand this, but in our previous study in our laboratory, we found that most genes that change the expression after acute exercise are associated only with contractile activity. Most of them are associated with contractile activity. It was a study a few years ago when we compare work leg and non-work leg, and we found this this point. So we understand this and think that contractual activity make big impact in the gene expression changes.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you. We're out of time. So I would like to thank all of our presenters. I thought that the quality of the presentations were excellent, and good luck in the YIA competition.